most people visiting Lambhill from the city have come to pay their respects to the dearly departed at the crematorium or in one of the cemeteries here that make up the Glasgow Western Necropolis complex. Developed over the late 1870s as a prestigious, though affordable and improved alternative to the overcrowded churchyard cemeteries of Glasgow, which, as a result of poor sanitation, posed a health risk to the environment and whose surplus land was now being sought for redevelopment. Set in the outskirts of the city, in picturesque surroundings, the complex provided the ideal location for the city's emerging middle classes to commemorate their dead and make a fitting public statement of their faith, wealth, and status. Made up of three cemeteries, the Western Necropolis complex is comprised of Lambhill Cemetery, St Kentigern's Roman Catholic Cemetery, and the Western Necropolis. The oldest graves of the complex are to be found in Lambhill Cemetery, such as this terribly weathered headstone, dating from 1883. The detail of its writing almost completely eroded. The main entrance to Lambhill Cemetery on Balmore Road is accessed through an impressive triumphal arch designed in the classical style by renowned Glasgow architect James Sellars. Sellars, who designed many important Victorian buildings in the city, is perhaps most remembered for his St Andrew's Halls, now the Mitchell Theatre, and the fountain at Kelvin Grove Park, and whose own memorial is also located here in Lambhill. Originally, two rectangular gatehouse lodges flanked either side of the entrance, but these were demolished in 1991 and the roadside windows bricked over. The magnificent B-listed gates that once adorned the entrance have been removed for storage after being damaged by a car, and there is still hope they can be repaired and returned to the site one day.
I don't know how people would feel about it, but I remember when I was wee, being up at the cemetery, Lambhill Cemetery, and I used to stand and watch things happening, and they used to bring a big van up, and they had a piece of ground open just at the other side of the field, the rails, and they would put the wooden boxes in and cover it up, and they just kept doing that till they filled it all up. I remember going out and I used to watch this, and I didn't know who they were or anything about them till one of the men told me that the men out of prison.
Like the old city that spawned it, St Kentigern's, which opened in 1882, is laid out in plots, over a modern grid pattern allowing for easy access by vehicle. What immediately strikes you when visiting St Kentigern's, apart from its massive scale, is that amongst the thousands of headstones of conventional graves are a large number of fine obelisks and stone crosses of various kinds, and sculptures of such quality of design that one would normally expect to find them on the tourist trail of the complex's more famous counterpart in the East End of Glasgow. Here you will find many familiar icons of Christian burial, and some quite mysterious. From the grandiose to the very humble. St Kentigern's is not without its celebrities. Amongst the family plots of everyday people, you may find the final resting place of some of those who in their respective fields of their profession put Glasgow on the world stage. People such as human tornado Benny Lynch, crowned world champion flyweight boxer in 1935, a title he defended 3 times in 3 years. An achievement not surpassed by any other British boxer since. Benny Lynch's memorial, erected by boxing fans, is in St. Kentigerns Cemetery.
I belong to Glasgow, dear old Glasgow town, but there's something the matter with.
And one of the most popular character comedians off stage and screen of the 1930s and 40s.
Well, this is Will Fyffe and two other great Scotchmen.
Will Fyffe, who's most remembered for his song I Belong to Glasgow, still a favourite of many a drinking party today.
Well, that's wonderful. You know, goodbye, lads. Goodbye, John. Goodbye. If I don't see you through the week, I'll see you through the window.
And the Glasgow belongs to me.
At the western boundary of St. Kentigern's Cemetery stands the memorial of the mass grave for 11 of the 22 men who perished with their fellow miners in the Cadder pit disaster in 1913. It was the worst mining disaster in the area. Over 50,000 people turned out to line the funeral processions, and local businesses in Postle and Lambhill ceased trading on the day, in a show of sympathy. 20,000 attended the unveiling on the 22nd of March, 1914. Memorial stones to the other remaining victims of different faiths are located in the complex and at Cadder and Ridgery cemeteries. On the centenary of the disaster, this St. Kentigern's memorial was restored, with another two being raised in Lambhill and Bishop Briggs, each now commemorating all of the victims together. Today, sadly, these are the only reminders of the area's coal mining past, and a bleak symbol of the harsh conditions faced by many here at the time. The Garnet Hill Synagogue is the mother synagogue of Glasgow and the oldest in Scotland, dating from 1879. In 1895, they purchased a section of the necropolis to establish the Garnet Hill Hebrew Congregational Burial Ground, and later shared with some of the Gorbals synagogues. There have been more than 1,000 Jewish burials here since. A prominent feature is the red brick and sandstone prayer house, built in the early 1900s for ritual preparation of the deceased before interment. Curved paths rise, then dip out of sight over small hillocks and slopes that lead through the landscaped plots of headstones and tall memorials, aligned in strict rows like player pieces on some colossal board game, where a movement may stretch surreptitiously over a lifetime. Throughout the cemetery, ample trees give shelter to the living and provide shade over those at rest. In this typically Victorian garden cemetery. the Western Necropolis is built over land which had previously formed the estate of Westfield Farm, the house of which stood on ground just opposite the cemetery gates. Here lie the late great Victorians of Glasgow, amongst others, once residents in the second city of the British Empire. In their day, the empire covered one-fifth of the globe, and Britain was the financial capital of the world. Great wealth was to be made in foreign trade or back at home amidst the rapidly expanding urban industrialisation, but only if you belonged to one of the fortunate classes. In Glasgow anyway, the fortunate classes had moved to new residences in Kelvinside, where it was believed possible to live upwind of the noxious fumes and soot that billowed from factory chimneys to the east, or they had vacated to the suburbs completely, far enough to escape the overcrowding and squalor of slum housing, now filled by migrant workers who arrived each month in droves, in hope and in poverty. This was an era of complex duality, where the wealthy classes cultivated an outward appearance of dignity and restraint, whilst indulging the free rein of an inner dark side. Having a prevalence for prostitution and child labour. But the late Victorians and their Edwardian successors here were of a different ilk, a new breed of philanthropists and their supporters who, confronted by political instability, broke ranks from the old world order to champion the plight of the urban poor and pushed for social reform. And this they done to great effect, eventually. Amidst high rates of infant mortality, mothers dying through hemorrhaging whilst giving birth, industrial and domestic accidents, not to mention a whole plethora of infectious diseases whose cure was uncertain. Death was part of people's everyday lives. And for the Victorians, became quite an obsession. And this obsession was not restricted to ornate memorials and elaborate funerals. Fashion played a big part in setting the scene. Social convention ensured that death lingered with the bereaved, especially the mourning customs for women. Not only was a widow expected to abstain from public life, she was required to wear black mourning clothes for 2 years before the transition to half mourning clothes allowed her the self-indulgence of a lighter shade, perhaps of grey or mauve, for a further 6 month mourning period. It was considered unlucky to keep mourning clothes, which meant buying a whole new set of funeral attire once the next dear one passed on. Mourning was a lucrative business. The Victorian death cult permeated all with ritual and pomp reserved for only a very few today. Contrary to popular belief, the average person of this era was far healthier, fitter and stronger than we are today. If you managed to survive childhood and avoided the worst of infectious diseases, you stood a good chance of reaching middle age, longer if you were wealthy. They were almost entirely free of degenerative diseases like cancer and heart disease. This was mainly down to having relatively little access to strong alcohol and tobacco, and were sustained by a nutrient-rich diet comprised of organic vegetables, berry fruits, whole grains and oily fish, almost 10 times more the nutritional intake considered normal today. And all this was balanced by their levels of physical activity, which were approximately twice ours. Not so surprising if one considers the long working day of, say, someone employed in the agricultural industry or a domestic servant in a Victorian household. Of course, this golden era of a healthier lifestyle did not last long. As more industry became mechanised and more of their food became replaced with processed foods, high in animal fat, salt and sugar. Regardless, Glasgow has traditionally had the lowest average life expectancy in the UK, and no one really knows why. With the passing of the old queen, a new era ushered in. The sanitary revolution brought improved social conditions, and advancements in medicine saw a dramatic reduction in deaths by infectious diseases. The once common sight of parents mourning the loss of their young became a rare thing. The future must have looked so promising. Nothing could have prepared them for when the doors of hell opened and youth harvested in the mass slaughter of the killing fields of the First World War. The cemetery complex contains hundreds of war graves of members of the Scottish Armed Forces. 355 from the First World War are located in the necropolis proper, with a further 124 Second World War graves scattered throughout. Also in the necropolis is a section of World War I graves for members of the Commonwealth, members of the Armed Forces of Canada and Australia. More prominent are the World War I memorials located at St Kentigerns, and this one in Lambhill, standing tall on a raised circular earth mound marking the passing of the hours like a giant sundial, dedicated to the sailors and soldiers who gave their lives. Once inside the necropolis entrance, you are met by two memorials. The first is this memorial commemorating the Second Boer War, and opposite this, a fine World War I memorial, the Cross of Sacrifice, with regimental emblems proudly displayed on the screen wall behind. Some 723,000 British servicemen were killed in the First World War, 1 in 8 of those during mobilisation. With a whole nation in shock and grieving, elaborate private funerals seemed to lose their meaning in the face of the mass graves of war, and mourning rituals became simplified, with many choosing cremation as the preferred method. Amongst some of the notable people laid to rest here are Sir William Alexander Smith, founder of the Boys' Brigade in Glasgow. He died in May 1914, shortly after receiving his knighthood from King Edward VII in Buckingham Palace. he was barely 60 years of age. 700 boys of the Glasgow Battalion lined a 3-mile funeral route to the necropolis, followed by thousands of men, women and children, all come to pay a last tribute to the man the whole city knew as their commanding chief of the boys' movement. In a touching last scene, the boys of the 1st Glasgow Boys' Brigade filed past the open grave and each cast into it a white flower. And the solitary bugler sounded the last post.